maybe find the still center, the pause in the day that gathers, stills, and restores us. Maybe make a space that deadens the worry and lets peace pour in, that balm that heals and restores us. Maybe hold back the words and leave a silent curve of wonder and expectation of what is still yet to be. May we gather here, each as we are, from all our distances to this place you have called home. Hello, thank you for letting us make this space with you again today, where we can linger and long and gather just as we are, bringing the world that we have experienced this week and know that it is loved and it is redeemed. I'm Roddy Hamilton, the minister in Newcopatrick, and given all the recent headlines of the pandemic roller coaster we are on, let's place all that here and find in among all the stories another story of peace, of patience, of God. And find time to breathe in God a little more slowly and pause a little longer and slow down everything, that we might know a God and a love right here beside us. Let us pray. Holy God, in your longing for us to pause and reach out to you, may you reach out to us and meet us in all we have been this week. May we bring the words that have hurt and the headlines that have worried and the anxiety that has troubled and let you hold it for us. Here, now. Holy God, loving God, ever present God, May we trust what we dare believe of a love that reaches into our world through the heart to touch us. A love that creates a space for all the words we need to use to speak of about our living, and draws us to listen to a promise that calls us by name, knows us by name, speaks each of our names, and tells us, you understand, you grasp, you recognize each concern. In such a place, may you encourage and enrich with compassion and grace each word and every silence of our prayers. Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debt, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. There are two extremes in the story today. The rush of healing and teaching and doing things, and the wilderness, praying, pausing, and reflecting. And they sit side by side. So here's a couple of hours only in the life of Jesus.
The reading is taken from Mark chapter 1, verses 29 to 39. As soon as they left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came out and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sunset, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons. And the whole city was gathered around the door, and he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place and prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go to the neighboring towns so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came out to do." And he went through Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons.
Apparently, if you wish to increase your lifespan, lower your stress levels, boost your intelligence, and want fuller, thicker hair, all you need to do is read. Who knew? You can get all of that and more from reading a book. Now, I understand most of that, except the thicker hair part. But that was according to an article on the best books to read during lockdown. I don't know about you, but I've still got the pile I was going to read during the first lockdown. If only I could read them quicker or spend just a whole day just reading. There are actually only two books I've ever read in one day. And both times you got a clear sense of how fast a story runs, which is what we often miss reading Bible stories in church. We do weekly installments, forgetting all these stories of Jesus happen back to back within a couple of hours of each other. If you want a book to read in one day, Can I suggest that you try Mark's Gospel? It's not very long, 16 chapters, but you'll get a sense of how quickly things happen. Events we imagine take a whole day in the life of Jesus happen in only a few minutes before he's propelled onto the next incident. And that's what's been happening over the last few weeks for us in our storytelling here. We've taken 3 weeks to tell a story that happened in probably less than 3 hours. Jesus has preached in the synagogue. He's confronted a demoniac. He's healed Peter's mother-in-law. And he's found himself in a quiet place to pray, only to be interrupted to go and do more healing. But this is what I came to do, says Jesus. But it's one story after another. And in all that rush, what did he come to do? Heal? Teach? Confront? We remember so many individual stories separated from each other. We perhaps miss the bigger picture. When Jesus says, "This is what I came to do," what did he come to do? So let's imagine ourselves way back at the beginning. We're beginning to hear rumours about Jesus. Remember, we're an occupied people. Life under empire isn't good. The Pax Romana, the famous Roman peace, where the occupiers were allowed to, or the occupied were allowed to live their religion and local customs. It really wasn't any kind of freedom. It really is quite brutal. It is our customs, but it's their way. The reality was life under empire did not invite the fullness of life. Yet here was someone who was inviting that. This is what I came to do. Not just curing people, but reattach them to each other. Create community again. This is what I came to do. Those who were ill, included back into that community which cut them off because of the fear others had of their illness. This is what I came to do. The possessed, freed back into life again and their families. This is what I came to do. He spoke truth to power, shaming those who bound up the lives of the least. This is what I came to do. Everything Jesus did, when you join up all the stories from exorcisms, table turnings, teaching, eating with sinners and tax collectors, confrontation with the authorities, all of that, all of these individual stories were about enabling people to find their humanity again, their relationships again, in a religion and an occupation that did the opposite. He came to enable people to find the fullness of life in a system that denied that. This is what I came to do, says Jesus. So all the individual stories come together and we discover that bigger story that calls us through the other side of this pandemic, bringing all our stories together and invites our teaching, our healing and spiritual care to come together to challenge that which corrupts our communities, relationships, parish, and bring people back into community. We're called to be the church of this bigger story that calls all in our communities into the fullness of life. This is what I came to do. Thank you. But there is a coda to all of this, and it is profoundly important. The yang to the yin of all that speed at which Jesus moved in sharing the kingdom. It always had him end up in the same place, wilderness and prayer. Looking after our spiritual needs is vital if we are part of this fast-moving story. The wilderness times, to admit what we can and cannot do, to connect with that which is bigger than us and know we are all part of it, to find the space within us that knows us as we are and loves us. That deeper meeting place, not set with words, but a place for silence and being and rest, where we can sense a truth that we are loved, held and known beyond everything that is happening in the rush and speed and anxiety of life. And while we can have grand visions of what the church can be like after pandemics, we also need the now in which to be held and loved and trusted and cared for. A place to breathe in God. And love is never far away. And hope is real. And God is closer than that breath we have just taken.
Listening God, here we are again, laying before you our concerns for our troubled world, just as the people brought to Jesus all the sick and suffering of the villages which he was visiting. We remember in our prayers all those who are ill, from whatever cause, and all their anxious relatives and friends, and we ask that they can feel that they are enfolded in your love. Be with all those who have lost a loved one, famous or known only to family and friends, and assure them that they will meet again in your presence. Loving God, bless all the caregivers in our communities and strengthen them in the challenges they face. Help us in our determination to include everyone in our circle of care and to look out for our neighbours all the time, and not just in times of trouble. Inspire all those who lead us in community, that we may all work together and in harmony to build back better for the world and future generations. Creator God, the first tentative signs of spring are appearing among the continuing signs of winter, just as the first signs of hope and progress have appeared in our communities. Help us to remember the sense of all being in this together with which this journey began a year ago, and to nourish, cherish and protect those vulnerable beginnings instead of falling into vaccine wars and selfishness. Forgive us our short memories, our readiness to embrace a selfish nationalism and our lack of humility, but rather help us to remember the motivation which drove so many to create a vaccine for all and inspire us to take a lead in helping to bring about your kingdom of peace, equity and love. All these things we ask of you. So be it. Amen.
And the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the commonwealth of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Once more, thank you for inviting us to join you today. Thank you to Jim who read, Alistair who prayed, Christine who played, and George who produced. Thank you to you all for your time in taking part in our video. We are busy online at nkchurch.org.uk, where you can catch up with all our events. You can subscribe to our weekly newsletter and email. You'll find out information about when our quizzes and sing-songs and discussions and coffee pot all happen in the week. This week we continue our global discussion of faith and life and church with a colleague from Australia, zooming in live to Babylon Files, but on Wednesday morning at 10 a.m. We have another virtual choir forming to record something for Easter, so if you'd like to sing and take part in that, it's just really for fun. The information is on the website and also in this week's email, but also on Easter Project. Information again in the email and on the website. Next time is our anniversary Sunday. That's Sunday the 14th of February. And while we'll have our normal video, we'll also have a live Zoom service too at 10:30. And the website will take you there and have all the information there too. So it's busy, busy, busy. But we've just heard that we should find a quiet place in the midst of everything. So I'm off to do just that. And I hope you can too. Take care.
It shall